Welcome back, folks. With me, Deborah Koyama, CMO Europe at Mondelez. Great company, ton of brands, international activities. We're very honored to have you.
Thank you.
How was
very honored to be here.
How was day one for you at this year's venue?
Oh, actually, it's my first time in Damexco.
Oh, so how was it?
I arrived last night, and I just came out of stage. Very exciting. It's big.
It's big.
Very big.
A lot of interesting brands and partners and agencies, I hope you're bumping into.
Yes.
As you know, we want to find out a little about the person here on stage, in this little studio, more about you as a person, as a private person. So my opening question has to be, how did you get in the industry and how long did it take to bring you or to get you in this CMO position? Because there are not so many female CMOs, I would say.
Yes. I don't know the statistics, I must say.
Me neither.
But you may be right, because I think there aren't that many women in C levels across the globe. I started 25 years ago, so it's a long time ago. My family heritage is Japanese, but I was born and grew up in São Paulo, Brazil. I started my career there 8 years. And I went to the States, to the U.S. to get my MBA at Northwestern. I'll shout out to my school, Kellogg. and stay in the States for the past 18 years. So I've done Brazil, Latin America, U.S. market, global. And then finally, I just moved to Zurich 7 months ago to do the Europe job.
So you got both. You got like the Japanese focus. You got the Latin American energy and all the passion for things you do, I would assume. And now you're in Zurich, and
yes.
You're precise like a Swiss watch. Was that a hard cut coming from the U.S.?
It was a big transition, I must say. I'm a big city person. I grew up in São Paulo, which is a 20 million people city. And then I spent the past 12 years in New York City, which is a big, intense city as well.
Yes.
And I love that kind of lifestyle. So it was a transition, but I'm very excited to be in Europe for the first time. I work for European brands and companies, but I'm excited to be living in the continent.
Mm-hmm.
I had a phenomenal summer. The
it
hottest
was an outstanding summer ever.
Another thing, this is not normal.
No.
I loved it. I'm very excited to be here.
So let me ask you, being a CMO, you have to orchestrate so many different teams and so many subjects and topics and so many technologies popping up around you. How do you manage that? You have teams remotely on different locations and offices. Do we have like dailies, weeklies? How do you work with them? Is it agile? How can I imagine
yes.
that?
Great question. So I'm in the role for 7 months. It's part of a bigger marketing ignition, if you will, for Mondelez. So we have each region has a CMO. I am obviously for Europe. And I think the first chapter of that journey was really to do a roadshow. So I just came out of 4 hubs in Europe,
okay.
touching 500 marketers. That's the number of marketers that we have in Europe only, which is very exciting. 50 countries, very different cultures. And obviously I have a direct team, a central marketing leadership team. We have functional experts in my team that has a big team under them as well. And then it really varies in terms of how we work. Obviously with my direct team, I have a weekly meeting. We're trying to have like now town halls with 500
okay.
marketers. So we're still really defining what's the best way to mm-hmm. stay connected with the community. Mm-hmm. Again, this is the beginning of the journey.
Wow. How do you motivate yourself and how do you pick up energy? What do you do to keep focused and have enough energy? Because I can imagine you got a pretty long day every day, a lot of traveling back and forth.
Yes, great question, especially this week. I mean, one country every day. I think people. I feed off people's energy. I love to interact with people, inspire people, enable people, and vice versa. I think people inspire me. So that's number one, and that's why I took this job. That's why I'm excited about the mission that we have and really like unleashing the talent at Mondelez. We
mm-hmm.
have the talent. The people are phenomenal. We have a phenomenal portfolio of brands as well. So that's on the professional side, if you will. Personally, I love to have a downtime, be it like gym, yoga, swimming, meditating, and then travel is another passion of mine. I've done 60 countries. I'm so excited that I'm in Europe, that hopefully that number can go high quite quickly.
Oh yeah.
So those would be my two big ones, traveling and making sure that I have my downtime.
Is there a specific country or a place you definitely want to head to and you make plans already?
No, I'm very excited actually I'm going to Warsaw tonight actually. I've been to Poland 20 years ago, so I'm happy to be back. No, I've been all over already in the summer.
Okay. Did you have a mentor or somebody who would give you advice when you look back, and did you take that advice?
Yes, I will talk about my ex-CEO with Anheuser-Busch InBev, Carlos Brito. He's a mentor to me. And I think one of his advices was to make sure that I can separate professional and personal life.
Okay.
I took that advice. I think it was a very wise one.
Okay. And how is it in your role now? Are you surrounded, of course, by seniors and directors, but also do you bump into juniors, and what kind of advice do you give juniors?
Yes, I love the juniors, if you want to call it that way, but I'm very excited, motivated, and rewarded to be able to connect with the next generation of talent in the organization. So not only in the roadshow, I was able to meet the more junior people out of the 500 marketers, but also every day people reach out, can I have a coffee or lunch? And I always will have time for them. Mm-hmm. So actually, that's a big inspiration for me, to be able to impact. And then what I told them, even the roadshow, is like, if I can leave as a legacy among the leads that I can inspire, especially the younger generation, to really do their best work at Mondelez, that would be like a massive achievement for me.
Do you personally have a favorite brand or a marketing channel in this portfolio you're really attached to, for what reason ever?
Wow, that's a very hard question, right? So, but I'm in charge of Milka, the chocolate and biscuit brand globally. So I must say I'm a little bit biased just because I'm taking care of that brand.
But which are great brands, by the way.
Thank you. But the portfolio of Mondelez, again, as I travel and I really get to know the regional or the local brands, even beyond the global brands, is like outstanding. It's just phenomenal. Like the reach, the power, the equity that we have in our portfolio is just like unbeatable. That's why we're the number one snacking company in Europe and globally. It's just like candy store. That's what I say.
Huge candy store.
Yes.
So this year, everybody at this venue speaks about blockchain, about voice, about AI, of course.
Yes.
How far along that path are you already? Now being 7 months on board, of course, maybe you're not in depth into every kind of, you know, any corner of the corporation. But how far along is Mondelez on this track?
We just spoke about this at the panel right now. I think there are pockets of excellence within Mondelez that I've seen these 7 months that I'm here with AI. I just mentioned Cadbury. We just launched a campaign with AI backed in terms of really inviting consumers to design their own flavor for Cadbury dairy milk.
Okay.
We just have also another example around Lacta chocolate that we also use AI. So there are some amazing initiatives happening among the leads, Europe as well as globally. But I think the challenge and the opportunity for me is like to help to make that a more scale and really have a more broader application of new technologies and experimenting, testing and learn. That's why I mentioned the digital accelerator. I think that's one way to bring and inject startups, fresh thinking, new technologies, solving business and brand challenges. So lots to do. This is only the beginning.
A lot to do, of course. Yes. And how important is social media? Got a lot of customer brands, of course, B2C brands. I would assume it's important, of course, but is it like, you know, the young folks are on Insta and on Snapchat, and maybe the older ones in the meantime are hanging around on Facebook, and of course you do all of them.
Yes.
But is there a channel that's really kind of, you know, hitting the ceiling at the moment in terms of reach or in terms of engagement, or is it possible to have some insights there, or is it just equal all over the portfolio and you just are present on all those channels?
Lisa, we are present in all the channels. Obviously, I think depending on the audience that you're trying to reach and connect with, mm-hmm. we're going to be prioritizing or choosing certain channels over other ones. And to me, it's very hard to say generally. It depends on the brand, on the audience or the target if you that you're trying to reach, the campaign or the objective of that specific business. So it's very hard. We work with all of them. I think the opportunity is to continue to partner with the key players in this space, but
definitely.
Also continue to innovate and see what's out there and test and learn and experiment. So hard to pinpoint one.
Okay. If I would set up a lunch tomorrow at lunchtime, a one-on-one with anyone on this planet, who would you like to have at a table?
A lunch? One-on-one?
Like for an hour or so, maybe two.
Live or dead?
Your choice.
I'm going to pick a personal choice than a dead person.
Okay.
I would pick Joseph Campbell.
Why is that?
Because he is very inspirational to me. I don't know if you know, but he wrote a very famous book called A Hero with a Thousand Faces.
Okay.
He's also the author of The Power of Myth.
No, I didn't know that.
And he talks about the hero's journey. And he's a big inspiration for me. I would pick him.
I'll try to make that happen.
Yes.
Who knows? Maybe, you know.
AI.
Oh, that's interesting. Yeah, AI. Yeah, that's interesting. Are you a heavy user on your phone, and what are the apps you really use?
I'm
intensely?
A very heavy user. Actually, I have two phones right now. I brought my New York City phone, so my folks are reaching me there, and obviously I have a Swiss phone. I have many apps. I got that question last night as well. I think the ones that I've been using a lot, not very new, but I'm very connecting in terms of fitness right now, is FitnessPal and Fitbit.
Okay, two good ones.
Yes, right.
By the way, two
I
good
like
ones.
Those a
yeah,
lot.
Yeah, yeah.
I use them every day.
In your free time, you said you do a lot of sports. That's an energy source. Is there a book you could recommend? I just asked you. Traveling we had, but I'm also interested in, is there some kind of passion in terms of, I don't know, a brand or a band, music type you're addicted to, you always listen to when you're, I don't know, either very happy or very sad. So is there something you really get attached to?
I'm going to do another advert, I guess. I love Spotify, so I love music. Hard to talk about one genre or mm-hmm. one band or one song. So Spotify is a big company for me.
Mm-hmm. So a huge universe of sources of inspiration or of music. So you listen to different types of playlists.
Everything.
Experiencing new stuff or discovering new stuff.
I love to discover, and I think Spotify is very good at that. So I love going to music festivals. So I love music.
Very good. So we'll let you rush, but first I want to thank you for stopping by, sharing some insights in this interesting life and job, of course. And I will keep our eyeballs on you and see how it's going for you in Switzerland. And hopefully you're able to travel all those countries in Europe you're interested in.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. That was Deborah Koyama. Thanks, guys.